Are you interested in computers? Do your friends and family always ask you for help with their gadgets? Do you work in IT and can't get enough of providing tech support to people who barely understand the machine they're using to earn a living? Is Linus Tech Tips your favorite YouTube channel? Then PC Building Simulator might be for you, and only you. I originally intended to build a new PC late last year. However, ever since the pandemic started, there has been a global shortage on components because everybody wanted to work from home. An additional roadblock, ironically, was that PC consumer hardware made a pretty big jump in performance last year. Nvidia's new graphics cards massively surpassed the previous generation, and they're also a lot cheaper by comparison. AMD finally managed to beat Intel on the processor front, and even their graphics cards are competitive with Nvidia, so many people pulled the trigger to replace their aging machines. And I was among those, since my current PC is now over 5 years old. It's still perfectly functional and it can run most games quite fine. But because I now no longer play my games on 1080p resolutions ever since I upgraded to 1440p monitors last summer, which is twice as many pixels, my GTX 980 Ti is starting to show its age. And since I also do quite a bit of content creation and 3D rendering from time to time, I could really use an upgrade from my quad-core i7-6700K. I actually have most of the hardware ready right now, but I'm still waiting for one crucial component, and that's the CPU. I've actually ordered it over 3 months ago, but the shortage is still not over, so I probably have to wait for a few more weeks for it to finally arrive. But in the meantime, Humble Bundle recently had the perfect game in one of their monthly bundles to scratch that itch of wanting to build a PC. To be honest, the existence of this game amuses me to no end. I mean, quirky and funny simulators with arbitrary themes have existed for quite some time now, so I'm hardly surprised that this game exists. It's not like this is an untapped market, and I guess every kind of activity can be turned into a video game simulation. But the question isn't if it can be made into a video game. The question is, should it be made into a video game? So let's find that out. I guess what impresses me the most is the sheer amount of accuracy in terms of the PC components at your disposal. The developers went so far as to license an expansive number of hardware and software products from dozens of manufacturers. And the nice thing here is that in terms of performance of those components, they basically didn't have to do any fine-tuning themselves because all the data is already there. Benchmarking your PC is pretty much the first thing any enthusiast does with their hardware, and the results of those benchmarks are publicly available to everybody. And tech reviewers usually go to great lengths in providing ample amounts of data for consumers to take into account when buying components. So I wouldn't be surprised if the benchmarking scores in the game actually reflected real-world performance numbers. But all of this is just a means to an end. What is the player's purpose in this game? It can't just be building your dream PC with the most top-of-the-line consumer-grade hardware, right? Because that would basically mean slapping together a PC with an AMD Ryzen 9 5900X, an Nvidia RTX 3080, plenty of RAM, a fast NVMe SSD, and calling it a day. No, your purpose is actually to run a PC repair business. So while the game does simulate the task of building a PC, the actual goal and what you spend most of your time doing is building your business and keeping track of inventory and finances in order to make sure all your tasks get done on time. Each day you get a handful of emails from people who need assistance with their PCs, or sometimes they ask you to build an entirely new one from scratch. Most of these requests feature clearly stated components that need to be replaced, and they give you a budget and sometimes a date until which the repair or build needs to be completed at. Some tell you which brand you're supposed to use because brand loyalty makes total sense, or they give you a game that the PC is supposed to run at minimum or recommended specs. Most customers also worry about having used products in their machines and specifically ask you to only put new hardware in their computer. And a few give you a specific target of a benchmark score, which is not really something I've ever heard PC enthusiasts actually caring about. Maybe there is a circle of people somewhere that's unhappy with their 3D mark score and they upgrade their machines for a specific score, but if those people truly exist, that would have to be the saddest rung of the nerd ladder to occupy. So the core gameplay loop consists of looking at those emails, figuring out which parts to order, keeping track of those parts in your inventory, removing and inserting components, testing if the PC works and reaches the required performance level, and sometimes you have to remove viruses or enter the BIOS for overclocking purposes. Now, since the game simulates all of these real physical products, you'd think it'd also introduce you into the world of PC hardware so you as a player know what the hell you're supposed to be doing. There is a basic tutorial at the start of the game that explains to you what type of hardware hardware a modern computer requires. It tells you that the motherboard has to be populated with a processor, a cooler for said processor, memory, storage, and a graphics card, and it also tells you that many of these components need to be plugged into a power supply or connected to other devices, but that's really the extent of it. If you don't already know the basic performance of the hardware at your disposal, you're pretty much out of luck. This is especially true because PC component manufacturers tend to be absolutely terrible with the naming of their products. Let's take graphics processors or GPUs as an example. And for simplicity, we'll focus on NVIDIA GPUs here. If you could choose between a GTX 980 and a GTX 1060, what would your conclusion be as to which of these two was the better product? The 1060 has a higher number, so you'd assume that that one would be better, right? And you'd be wrong, because NVIDIA doesn't name their GPUs in a linear fashion where the newer one with a higher number automatically outranks the previous one. Nowadays, NVIDIA GPUs are all released as part of a product family or series. So the 980 is part of the 900 series and the 1060 is part of the 10 series. NVIDIA previously incremented their series by 100 with each new generation, so you had the 100, 200, 300 series up to the 900 series. And once they reached 1000, they started renaming them to the 10, 20 and now currently the 30 series. So the first two digits of the four-digit number represents the series. The last two numbers in the name of any given GPU determines its rank within a given series. Typically, the lowest number given to consumer-grade gaming GPUs is 50, so there was a GTX 950 and there was also a GTX 1050, and the 1050 was the direct successor to the 950. But it wouldn't necessarily match the performance of the previously higher tier of GPUs, so a 1050 wasn't as fast as a 960. The product names within a series usually increment by 10, so the product stack from the 900 series looked like this. A few of the cards would get the suffix TI, which indicated a revised or superior model to the base model of the same name, and during the 20 series, NVIDIA added the suffix Super as a second variation with an increased price point to match the increase in performance. Now, while I've mentioned that a newer, lower-class GPU wouldn't necessarily reach the performance of a previous, higher-class GPU, that was the case specifically between the 900 and 10 series. If you look at the 20 and 30 series, those paint a completely different picture, with an RTX 3070 outclassing an RTX 2080 Super and almost reaching the RTX 2080 Ti, a GPU that cost nearly 3 times as much at launch. Now, this entire tangent isn't supposed to be a comprehensive guide to PC hardware, after all I just looked at a single part by a single manufacturer. But it illustrates the problems with using real PC hardware in your games. And if you didn't already know all of these nuances, and believe me, I left out a lot in that little summary, I didn't even mention add-in board partner models or pre-overclocked cards, you wouldn't have a clue what the best type of hardware would be in any given situation. And the game gives you very little information on how you would actually go about building a computer that would match a given performance requirement within a given budget. And it's not like you have a way of practicing this stuff somehow and get a feel for it. The game does give you a tool that ranks hardware relative to other hardware, but you actually need to buy it with the in-game money you earn from completing jobs. Jobs which require this basic knowledge before you're even able to get that far. I'm not sure if this was deliberately set up this way in order to have players struggle before the game throws you a bone or not, but regardless of the intent, the result is that if you're not already an enthusiast and know all of this stuff, it's almost impossible to overcome this barrier. So the question now is this game even intended for an audience that isn't already deeply invested in PC hardware? Because if it is, it does a terrible job at introducing newcomers to whom I would definitely not recommend this game. It reflects the difficulty of getting into it in real life, and I lay the blame squarely at the terrible way companies name and market their products. But if it really is intended for the hardcore nerd crowd that can rattle off component specs in their sleep, who know the names of lead engineers working at Intel, AMD and Nvidia and spend their free time on forums talking about process nodes and IPC performance increases, I'd argue that the game doesn't go far enough to accurately represent how building a computer works. It gets the tedious bits about working as a PC repair person right. Putting a motherboard into a PC requires you to first put in standoffs and then screwing in the motherboard with 6 or 7 screws. And that's tedious, especially if you have to do it over and over again. Inserting RAM is painstakingly realistic, where you first have to pull back the retention tabs before you can insert the stick. And a secondary goal is actually getting rid of said tedium by giving you upgrades that plug in all the external cables or cause screws and standoffs to automatically screw themselves in instead of having you press a mouse button for a few seconds on every single screw. But this attention to detail and realism doesn't extend to other sections of the game. So while it's important that you don't forget to put thermal compound on your processor before you mount the cooler, the actual heat output of the CPU doesn't seem to matter with regards to which cooler you put in. More powerful CPUs usually put out more heat than lower power ones, and you need to get rid of that heat somehow or your CPU won't perform as well as it could. And as far as I can tell, this aspect is entirely absent in this game. The game also unlocks newer hardware very slowly. The hardware that's available to you at the start of the game represents the time between 2015 and 2017. So on the Intel side you have the Skylake microarchitecture that came out in 2015, and for AMD you have the Ryzen 1000 series on offer that came out in 2017. For graphics cards it starts with the aforementioned Nvidia 900 series from 2015 and whatever corresponding GPUs AMD was churning out at the time with their incredibly confusing naming scheme. And even after playing the game for 8 hours, the game has barely unlocked anything newer than that. I can now use the lower class 10 series GPUs from Nvidia, but the only CPUs available to me from Intel are still Skylake and Ryzen 1000 from AMD. But all of these complaints about the massive lack of player handholding and slow unlocks are overshadowed by a far larger problem the developers are entirely oblivious about. It's the fact that PC building is seen as an end in and of itself, and that's simply not what building a PC is about. A computer is just a tool that allows you to do other stuff. I don't sit at my desk and marvel at the hardware that's in that black box sitting next to me. I use my PC to play games, to make videos, edit photos, play around in 3D software, even do a little bit of programming for myself. I use it to access information and entertainment or communicate with other people online. Basically, the hardware sitting on my desk is not what's important. The numbers it manages to generate in benchmarks are meaningless. Compare it to a workshop. It's filled with tools and machines, hammers, saws, etc. But nobody goes into such a workshop to simply admire those tools. It's what those tools allow you to create or repair, the inherent potential that those tools represent, that's important. And this aspect is entirely missing in PC Building Simulator. Owning and running a PC repair business isn't just about taking apart PCs and putting them back together. It's also the interpersonal stuff surrounding that, dealing with customers, making sure they're getting exactly what they need. And while the emails you get from customers are sometimes very creatively written and certainly speak from experience with people who are completely oblivious as to how computers work, it's an entirely passive aspect of the gameplay experience. There's no back and forth between you and any given character, no actual consulting is going on. You just accept their requests, order the necessary parts, and do the same repetitive disassembly and assembly over and over again. As such, the game really just boils down to the most repetitive and tedious aspect of working as a PC repair tech. And while the attention to detail and realism of the components at first are a wow factor, they quickly reveal themselves to be confusing for all but the most tech-savvy nerds. That, coupled with the extremely slow unlock progression, means that much of your time is spent repeating the same things over and over again, which is why after 8 hours I had to call it quits and simply do something else with my time.